I'm nowhere near the angry person that I was when I came in, whether I was hiding it or whether it was out there, I was screaming on the job or some stupid something, you know, being a lunatic. It definitely is my number one offender. And fear being at the basis of those resentments, along with the second list being fears, even though there's no resentment in connection with them, we reviewed our fears thoroughly, we put them on paper, even though we had no resentment in connection with them, is basically the combination of all resentment being based in fears, and fears being, you know, the second one of the four lists here. I consider fear to be, you know, the basically what we're doing in here is to be free of this fear. And it outlines the solution to fear. We asked him to remove our fear and direct our attention to what he would have us be. At once we commenced to outgrow fear. And on that idea, we look and see that why does turning my attention to what God wants me to do relieve my fear? Because what God wants me to be is someone who does things for other people and cares about other people and has genuine concern for other people. And once I start doing that, then I begin to stop thinking about myself all the time. Therefore, now that I'm doing what God wants me to do, and I'm thinking about other people, and I'm living my life, I have an extreme example of that that I like to say is that basically my only reason for living today is those people in my life. I know I don't always exhibit that behavior, but I do have that idea. Progress, not perfection. I do have that idea in my head because I remember the day when I was about four blocks from here walking down the road ready for another weekend run, and I said to myself, you know what? If this is what life has in store for me, I think I'd just rather not. You know, I think I'll be on my way now, is pretty much the thought that went through my head. And that was the night I met a couple of detectives over there, Nick Navarro's finest, back in 1990. And to me, I consider that to be the turning point in my life in which, I came to the end of my selfishness and self-centeredness to where I was like the reason for my life. Everybody in this world was put here for me, just completely turned around now. I can see that that was not only the wrong way to live, but if I continue to live that way, I wasn't going to live much longer. That's all there was to it. So now today, when I ask God to remove my fear and direct my attention to what He would have me be, at once I commence to outgrow fear, because all this fear is based in self. Self-centered fears that I'm not going to get what I want, that I'm going to lose what I have. I'm so afraid of you know, getting kicked out of my apartment, losing my job, crashing my truck, everything that you can think of, whatever it is, getting cancer, losing the people that I love to car accidents or cancer or whatever it is that takes people's lives out of your life. All those fears are self-centered fears. And to think and do things for other people is the basis of this faith in God thing. And the idea is that we do the work outlined, and then one day, what's it say, the promises of the ninth step, one day it's just there, you know. The promises of the tenth step are even more to the point. I'll read them real quick and get some idea of, I mean, everybody's heard them before, they might not realize it, but the promises of the tenth step say, and we have ceased fighting anything or anyone, even alcohol, for that by this time sanity will have returned. The sanity that we're talking about is that first drink they put down in front of you. I used to say, well, it's been a year. I got a year sober. I can take one drink now. I did that with cigarettes for months. I got six or eight months. One cigarette, it ain't going to hurt. The same stupid thing I did with the booze, you know. 6 months, great. I bet I can have one this time. And then a week later, I was, you know, off on another one, losing the job, getting kicked out of wherever it was I had. Everybody was leaving again. That's the sanity we're talking about. My reaction to that first drink, for by this time, in the tenth step, sanity will have returned. We will seldom be interested in liquor. If tempted, we recoil from it as if from a hot flame. We react sanely and normally, and we will find that this has happened automatically. We will see that our new attitude toward liquor has been given us without any thought or effort on our part. In other words, if I find and be rid of the things that are blocking me from doing God's will. Selfishness, self-centeredness, the four of them are resentment, fear, selfishness, dishonesty. I find and be rid of those four things, and this happens automatically. I react sanely and normally, and I will find that this has happened automatically. We will see that our new attitude toward liquor has been given us without any thought or effort on our part. It just comes. That's the miracle of it. So that's what we're saying here in the steps. I got sponsees who do the steps with me and go out and get drunk and then, you know, wonder, what did I do wrong? They said, we have to go back to step one. I said, no. You got to go back to step 11 and start doing the daily inventory. Every single day you have to do an inventory to find and be rid of what's blocking you from doing God's will and apply the solution to be free of those things. And the constant thought of other people is going to be what my whole sobriety is going to be based on. You know, I like to take it a little further than that too and say, you know, maybe there ain't this kind of creepy ghost thing going on there where it's like this Holy Father art in heaven thing, and it's just a matter of doing what's good and making you feel good. My sponsor even says it. He's a real religious guy too, and he says, it's this simple, dummy. You do good, you feel good. You do bad, you feel bad. It's that simple. It really is. So that's the basic idea behind what we're talking about here is that doing things for other people and thinking about other people is going to make me feel good about who I am. That's all there is to it. It may take a while, and here's another key point that I heard over the years, and what that key point is, if I do something for somebody, and I'm thinking in my head, my motives are, all right, I'm going to do something for you, but you better show me that you appreciate it, you better make an attempt to pay me back, and la-di-da, la, you know, the same old selfish things that drove me to do things for people in the past, if those motives are underlying in those things that I do for other people, then it doesn't work. Because you have to do things for other people and say, I did that because I wanted to do it, because it's going to make me feel good about who I am. And whether or not they pay me back, you know, hey, that'd be great if they did, but I'm not going to count on it. And I'm not going to let my sobriety or the way I feel about who I am ride on whether or not they pay me back or whether or not they exhibit that they appreciated what I did for them. I do something for somebody and they still treat me like shit. You know what I say? I'm not going to do anything for that one anymore. I'll pick somebody else. And it really is that simple for me today. It's just a matter of thinking about other people and doing things for other people and not putting conditions on what it is, you know, like the you pay me back conditions. Those are, what did somebody say, those are selfish motives behind an honest, selfless act. And it doesn't work. It's sent for the simple fact that you can see that it doesn't work. I mean, I can see it. I don't know. I might not be able to see it when I first got sober, but I can see it now. But the fifth step, you say, why is he talking about all this stuff in the fifth step? Because the fifth step really is that simple. You just, we'll read a little bit of what it says here. Into action. I got what's called, Jim B., the instructions for the fifth step on 75 within the four pages that are outlined for the fifth step in the big book. Having made our personal inventory, this is chapter 6, into action on page 72 at the top. I'll read it real quick, it won't take long. Having made our personal inventory, what shall we do about it? We had been trying to get a new attitude, a new relationship with our Creator, and to discover the obstacles in our path. We have admitted certain defects. We have ascertained in a rough way what the trouble is. We have put our finger on the weak items in our personal inventory. Resentment, fear, selfishness, dishonesty. Now these are about to be cast out. This requires action on our part, which when completed will mean that we have admitted to God, to ourselves, and to another human being the exact nature of our defects. This brings us to the fifth step in the program of recovery mentioned in the preceding chapter.